You search for me with all your heart. I'm going to read it again. This is God speaking to you. It says, then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this morning. Thank you for allowing us to see another day. Thank you for your grace upon our life that is so wonderful. Thank you that we have a God we can look to as our Father. Thank you that you are a place of refuge. You are our helper. Lord, you are our strength. Father, we want to thank you. Lord, as we go into your word this morning, we ask for utterance. We ask, oh God, that you give us the wisdom to be able to appropriate your word into our lives. Father, give us the grace to be obedient to your word. Father, we want to thank you today. Holy Spirit, we ask, oh God, that you help us, oh God, to understand your word. Give us a revelation of your word today. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. The title of the message today is called Living a Life of Prayer. Living a Life of Prayer. God has called all of us, his children, to live a life of prayer. Before Jesus said in Luke 18:1, he said, men ought always, the key word is always, to pray and not to faint or not to lose heart, meaning that we should not give up. Luke 18:1. God also spoke to prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7. God said, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. Do you know that no man is greater than his prayer life? Every genuine believer would like to do something great for God. But do you know that to be much for God, we must be much with God in the place of prayer. To be much for God, we have to be much with God in the place of prayer. I've come to a conclusion that prayer is the lifeblood of a believer. You know, without prayer, a believer cannot consistently live a victorious life. Do you know that what oxygen is to a human life is what prayer is to a believer? Do you know that when one lacks, our medical people will tell us, when one lacks oxygen, doctors tell us what happens is their organs begins to shut down one after the other. Human life cannot be sustained without oxygen, because after a little while, the organs, critical organs, begins to shut down. That is exactly what happens in the spirit. When one is not praying, their spiritual life begins to get weakened and diminished. It begins to be a lot weaker and weaker. Do you know that God told the priest in the Old Testament in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 13, Leviticus 6:13, God told them, he said, the fire shall always be burning on the altar. It should never go out. In the Old Testament, in the Holy of Holies, God told the priest specifically, make sure that the fire is always burning on the altar. What is the relevance of this? Do you know that the burning of incense is symbolic of our prayer according to the Bible? And it's symbolic of the prayer of the people rising to God. Psalm 141 verse 2. Psalm 141 verse 2. It says, let my prayer be set before you as an incense, the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. I want you to begin to see prayer as something that is so vital in your life. You know, don't treat prayer as something that you only want to do when you feel like it. remember, I liken prayer as oxygen, what oxygen does to a human being. Prayer is the same, but it's for a human soul. Our Lord Jesus was the man of prayer. Bible records many times that he will rise up early in the morning. In Mark 1:35, Bible says, now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and he departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. Our master lived on prayer. He was always communing with his Father. In Mark 13:25, Bible says Jesus was talking about a parable of that a man went to sow seed, and whilst men slept, the enemy came and sowed tears. Now he was talking about a farmer, you know, physically speaking, but always we can translate that into the spirit. Jesus said, while men slept, in Matthew 13:25, the enemy came and sowed tears. I can translate that spiritually to mean that when we are asleep spiritually, that is when the enemy comes a lot of times to attack. So you must wake up from slumber. The Lord has saved us, but he expects us to be people, to live a life of prayer. May you receive today a new fire and a new grace to desire prayer more and more. Say amen.
Amen.
I saw some quotes on prayer. There's a gentleman called Leonard Ravenhill. He's a man is trying to be with the Lord. He was an English evangelist. He said, prayer is to the believer what capital is to a businessman. A businessman can never go into a business without capital. You need money. And this man said, for a believer, prayer is your capital. Without prayer, one cannot succeed in kingdom business. In fact, Martin Luther, the great church reformer, he said, and I quote, to be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing. It means you can't be a Christian and not be prayerful. You know, one of the significant things that happened during the first church, in the early church, and in the Bible, they were people of prayer. They would meet every day, they would pray. I think life obviously has changed quite a lot since then. But the reason why they walked in so much power, raising the dead, healing the sick, demons screaming, just looking at them, was because they were people of prayer. Living a life of prayer for a believer is actually non-negotiable. You see, the agenda for today is just to get you up to that another level. Whoever is listening, even online, is to, my prayer is that the Holy Spirit, even if you're at that level, you can still go higher. Say amen.
Amen.
No matter what level you are, God wants to take you higher. You see, always remember one thing. Prayer is the lifeblood of a believer. A man can never exist without blood. If you drink the blood, in fact, the life of a person is in the blood. If you drain the blood from a human being, they die off because blood carries oxygen in our organs and all over. And that is what prayer does to the spiritual life of a believer. And a time must come in our life, every time we must remember, not out of duty, but out of realization that our Lord Jesus gave us an example. He was a man of prayer. Do you know that prayer outlived the lives of those who uttered them? Prayer doesn't die, you know. Revelation 5:8 says, now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints and Christians. Do you know the prayers you say today, even for your children, they are eternal. They're not, you don't just pray and that's the end of it. According to this scripture, those prayers, they are like in a bowl in the presence of God. They are like incense in the presence of God. Prayer should not be regarded as a duty, but as an obedience to the Lord. Do you know the secret of praying? Somebody made a statement and said the secret of praying is praying in secret. A sinning man will stop praying, and a praying man will stop sinning. If you get your prayer level to a level, sin will just drop off automatically. The reason somebody put in an analogy one time that if you have, a hot plate, say like a cooker, even flies will not go near it because there's heat there, you know. It's the same thing. When you are so full of prayer and the enemy stays away, I've read books where people that used to be in the kingdom of darkness, they said in the spirit they can see those who are really, really praying, and they stay away from them because there's a light around them that's so bright. They said they stay away. But people in the kingdom of darkness, when one is not prayerful, the light is very dim. I've said this before. I went to work one time, and a woman saw me, and she said, "You're a Christian." And I said, "How did you know? I'm meeting her for the first time." She said, "I can see a light around you." I said, "Really?" You know. But what am I saying here? The people in the kingdom of darkness, they understand the importance of prayer. When you pray, God's glory comes upon you. When Moses went to see God on the Mount Sinai to get the Ten Commandments, when he came back, you see, when you pray, you are talking to God, you are encountering God, and His presence comes mightily upon you. They said a man by the name Charles Finney, an evangelist 20 years ago, he will be walking on the street, people will be coming to him, they'll be repenting of, this is true, they'll be repenting of their sins. You know why? This man would spend like four, it was easy for him to spend 4 or 5 hours in prayer. He always says that, "I have so much to do, I have to spend at least 4 to 5 hours in prayer every day." Sometimes we struggle to even do 1 hour. This man, people would just go and be repenting of their sin. Do you know the secret of all failure is a failure in secret prayer? May you receive grace today to step up your prayer life in Jesus' name. Amen. There was a region in Africa where people started getting saved, and they were some of them are first converts to Christianity. They suddenly understood the importance of having a secret place to pray. So it was a village. So they created a little cubicle away from their houses differently to go and pray every time. So each person had like a little, path that they take to go and pray every day. The villagers reached these prayer rooms by using their own private footpath through the bush. When grass began to grow over one of those trails, it was evident that person to whom it belonged was not praying much. Because these new Christians are concerned for each other's spiritual welfare, a unique custom sprang up. Whenever anyone noticed an overgrown prayer path, he or she would go to the person and lovingly say to them, "Friend, there's grass on your path." So I want to ask you today, is there grass on your path? Why is prayer so important in the life of a believer? You know that prayer is what unlocks heaven's gates and gives us access to the great and mighty promises that God has for us. Amen? Yeah. Bible talks about Peter. He was kept in prison in Acts chapter 12. The Bible says constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And an angel went there to rescue him. You know, I've always thought about this scripture, you know, Acts chapter 12, verse 5, Acts 12, 5. Do you know that? I've always thought about this scripture. Peter was kept in prison, but constant prayer. I've always thought that if the church were not praying, does it mean that God would not have dispatched the angel? Do you know that? It is not enough to know about prayer. We have to pray. You know how to pray actually by praying. A lot of times it's important to understand the humiletics and the strategies of prayer. But what is important more is actually to pray. There was a man by the name Epaphras in the Bible. Paul was writing to the church in Colossians 4:12. And he says, Epaphras, Colossians 4:12, who is one of you, a bond servant of Christ? He says, greets you, always laboring fervently for you in prayer, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God for your life. You see, the reason why people don't pray, prayer is costly. It's labor. But may the Lord give every one of us grace to step over prayer life in the name of Jesus. Do you know Jesus is our example? He was a man of prayer and is actually still praying for us. In Hebrews chapter 7 verse 25, talking about our Lord, he said, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly faith. Do you know that? Even as we speak, Bible says the Lord Jesus is forever living to make intercession. He's praying for you even as we speak, even in heaven. And we need to imitate him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Do you know that? God loves us and he wants to answer our prayer. Don't ever get a feeling that you are approaching an unwilling God who doesn't want to answer prayer, who is reluctant. Going back to our main text, look at what God said in Jeremiah 29. Jeremiah 29 verse 12 to 13. He says, then you will call upon me and go and pray to me and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Do you know that God is more interested in us praying than even us praying? There's a general belief that God is reluctant, you know, and the reason is that sometimes there are delays or there may be one or two things, but the truth is that should not stop us from praying. Jesus said in John 15:7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask me what you desire, and it shall be done for you. John 15:7. In John 16:24, it says, until now you have asked nothing in my name. Say, ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. I want to quickly, just for about 15 minutes, just share five keys, or what I call vital keys to us receiving answers to prayer. Five keys or five vital keys to receiving answers to prayer. This is not exhaustive. I mean, it's just things that I personally find quite key. Number one, pray fervent and heartfelt prayers. Pray fervent and heartfelt prayers. One of the vital keys of receiving answer to our prayer is that prayer must be fervent. What does fervent actually mean? You know, fervent means intense. It means passionate. It means showing great warmth or intensity. Bible says in James 5:16, it says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. The Amplified Version says the earnest, the heartfelt, continued prayer of a righteous man makes tremendous power available. Fervent means intense. It means it must be heartfelt. Do you know that Bible looks at our hearts? Bible says God is not like man that looks on the outward, he looks at their heart. So when you're praying, what is on your heart? Do you know that one of the reasons why God did not answer the prayers of the Israelites at one point is actually found in Hosea chapter 7. Listen to this, Hosea 7:14. This is God speaking. Hosea 7:14. God said, they did not cry out to me with their hearts when they wailed upon their beds. They did not cry out to me with their hearts when they wailed to me upon their beds. Do you know that? I like the Moffat translation. He said, they never put their heart into their prayer. When you're praying, whether you're joining a prayer line or you're praying by yourself, are you actually engaged? Is your heart truly engaged? You know, sometimes we're praying and we're picking up phone calls. Sometimes the telly is on, you're watching the telly, and you're praying. That does not work. God says your prayer must be heartfelt. It must be fervent. Your heart must be engaged in it. Nothing must come between your prayer and the Lord. Are you distracted? You know, do you, you know, sometimes you're praying, somebody's trying to talk. I've seen it. Those kind of things. You know, God, Jesus said, when you want to pray, go into a room, lock the door behind you, and talk to your Father. Sometimes we think we're praying, but we're not. We're so distracted, we're praying, but our mind, you remember, the prayer God is looking for is something that comes from your heart. Bible talks about Hannah when she prayed to the Lord. Bible says she was speaking in her heart. Our heart must be engaged, not our head. Bible says God looks at your heart. What is in your heart? Do you know you can be thinking of something separately and your heart is totally somewhere else? Bible says in Isaiah 29:13, therefore the Lord said, inasmuch as these people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts far from me. One can remove their heart far from God, and one can look like they actually pray, but they're not. Psalm 62 verse 8 says, trust in him at all times. You people, pour out your heart before him. God is our refuge. Say amen. How fervent was Jesus' prayer in Hebrews 5:7? I read the scripture earlier, saying, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death and was heard? You see, Bible says there was a time Jesus was praying, he was sweating blood. That's passionate. Let me quickly go through four more. So remember, when effective prayer that are fervent, that are heartfelt, it touches your heart. You are engaged. You are not distracted watching telly or checking WhatsApp messages. We need to honor God. We are talking to the creator of the whole universe. Do you know, even when you go to see the queen, they said when they want to give people like OBE and stuff, you don't go before her and just talk, you know, check your phone. You know, they take everything off. You honor her. There's even a way you have to bow. Now you are talking to the King of Kings. Amen? So I want, you see, sometimes it is the little foxes that spoil the vine. Things that we don't count, that we think it doesn't really matter, that can be a big hindrance. But today, receive knowledge in Jesus' name. Number two, we need to persevere in prayer and don't never give up. Jesus said in Luke 18:1, when he spoke about a parable, it's about a woman that went to see a judge, that the judge should deliver her from her adversary. And Bible says that the judge would not listen to her. But after a while, the judge said, I don't want this woman to weary me. I'm going to give her what she wants. And then the Lord said, that how much more your father will he not give you what you want? Will he not speedily give you what you require? What we're saying here is that we need to persevere. That woman persevered. The Lord was teaching us about perseverance. Some prayer, answers to some prayer doesn't come immediately. And the Lord wants us to hang in there. You know, the main reason we lose heart and we give up is because of delays. But you need to remember that God's delays are always for our good sometimes. When we've done our own part, even if there are delays, remember, God never delayed answer because of a lack of care, but or a lack of power. God delays are always for our good. God knows exactly what he is doing. So remember, there was a time prophet Elijah, he prayed, and the man was so powerful, he wrote, in fact, the way he was introduced in the Bible, in 1 Kings, I think chapter 17, he just was introduced like a man from a prophet from Tishbite. He said, there shall be no rain or dew except at my word. The man was so powerful. He said, unless I say so, there's not going to be rain for the next few years. Obviously, God was the one talking to him that spoke to him. Then after the 3 years, Bible says, God then told him that there shall be rain in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 1. And Bible says, even though God has spoken that there's going to be now rain, Elijah still had to pray. When God speaks promises to our life, we still need to pray it through. Bible says, remember, God spoke to him, 1 Kings chapter 18, I think in verse 1, 1 Kings 18, chapter 1. You want to look into Elijah, he told him, he said, go present yourself to heaven, and I will send rain. God had spoken that there will be rain. But guess what? The prophet still has to pray. And Bible says, as he was praying, he put his head behind his knee. And he would tell his servant, go and check whether there was rain. The guy was going back and forth. After the seventh time, he said, oh, I can see a little cloud like the hand of a man. Elijah said, yes. Go and tell him that rain is coming. In fact, you need to get out of here because rain is going to start pouring now. What is it to learn from here? Elijah never gave up. When God has spoken, we must not give up. Amen. Elijah knew that sometimes answer doesn't come immediately, but we still persevere in prayer. How many times have you prayed about that situation that you've given up already? As long as it's the will of God, God expects us never to give up on prayer. Do you know God told Noah? God told Noah that there will be a flood. But the flood actually came 100 years later. People were making fun of Noah. That where is the flood? Where is the so-called flood? It did not happen until about 100 years. God promised Joseph in his teenage years that he was going to, he dreamed that people are going to be bowing down, it's going to be great. But this guy went through the Egyptian dungeon. He went through a lot of challenges. So just because of challenges doesn't mean that God's promises will not come to pass. We should persistently bring our requests before God. Remember, prayer is our lifeblood. You cannot give up on prayer. You cannot. It's like oxygen. Once oxygen depletes from a human being system, all the organs begin to shut down. When one stops praying, I'm telling you, spiritually, if it's just going to be like what Jesus said, that the enemy came, will come, and so may the enemy not sow tears in your field in Jesus' name. Number three, very quickly, vital keys to receiving answers to prayer. Pray in the name of Jesus. You may say that, oh, I always pray in the name of Jesus, but I'm going to describe what I'm saying here. In John 14, 13 to 14, Jesus said, and whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. You may say, oh, I always pray in the name of Jesus. But I'm talking about a mindset. When we go before God, you know, you can go with a mindset that, oh God, I did not sin yesterday. I was so holy. In fact, better than those people. You are not going in his name. Going in his name means we have no other basis to approach the living God except through the name of Jesus. He's the only one that's given us access to the Father. When we come in the name of Jesus, we come on the basis of the merit of Jesus Christ. You know, it's very easy to approach God with pride at God. I don't fornicate, I don't steal, I don't do this. One has got it wrong. You go humbling yourself and say, God, I'm only approaching you because of your Son. It's your Son that's giving me access to you. We're not coming because of what we are or who we are. We're coming on the basis of who He is and what He has done for us. Say amen. Our access to the Father is only through Jesus Christ, not through religion, not through our righteousness. Ephesians 2:18 says, for through him we both have access by one spirit to the Father through Jesus Christ. So when I say pray in the name of Jesus, I'm not just saying that ending your prayer, but when you go before Him, remember only Christ can make that prayer work, if that makes sense. Amen. The secret to prayer, to answer prayer, is to get your eyes off yourself and off your problem. Put it on Jesus. The more you look at the problem, the bigger it becomes. The more you think about your problem, the more your faith starts sinking. You know, that's why the Bible says in Psalm 143 verse 1, say, hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my supplications. In your faithfulness, answer me. And in your righteousness. You are not coming on your own basis of your own righteousness, but you are coming on the basis of God's faithfulness and God's righteousness. Say amen. Amen. So it's a mindset. So when you go before God, you are not, John the Baptist said that I may decrease while you increase. When you go before Him, remember you are nothing before Him. But Jesus said, without Him, you are nothing. Don't go before Him and have that mindset that, Lord, you know, I didn't sin yesterday. Doesn't expect you to sin if you're a child of God anyway. We go before Him thinking, God. You remember Jesus spoke about a man that was praying in the temple. One came and said, the Pharisee, look, I don't see, look at this sinner. And one man went before and said, God, I can't even look up to you. Have mercy upon him. And Jesus said, you see that one that's crying out to God, receive much more than this one. That Pharisee, they don't sing. They every little dot of the law, they obey to the letter. But God says that his heart was not right. So remember, when we go before God in prayer, we're going empty. We say, Lord, except you do it, it cannot be done. Only you can make it. We say, amen. That was like Samuel said in Psalm 121, verse 1. I will lift up my eyes to the hills, not to yourself. I'm emphasizing this one because sometimes we think we're so holy. Of course, God expects us to be holy. Like, I'm not that great in sin. What I'm saying is that when we go before God, we go empty and say, Lord, only you can make this. That was what Jehoshaphat did. And God said to him, if I won't fight in this battle, the battle is mine. God took it over immediately because he didn't see himself as anything. Anything that we ask because of Christ, say amen. Amen. Never come to God on any other basis apart from the name of Jesus. His name opens us doors. That's why we can command spirit that we don't even see with our naked eye, and they listen and they obey. Because the Bible says at the mention of his name, every knee shall bow. Say amen. Amen. Say, oh, I forgot that you can't respond. Okay, so it's only in his name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Quickly, I need to finish in 2-3 minutes. Number four, how can we get our prayer answered? This is a very practical number. Number four, check your motive, attitude, and forgive if somebody has offended you. Check your motives, attitude, and forgive. Do you know asking? Bible says in James 4:3, check your motives, your attitude, and forgive. If somebody has offended you, we've had this before, but sometimes the way actually be James 4:3, Bible says that you ask, you do not receive because you ask and means that you may spend it on your pleasure. Do you know that God looks at our heart? What is your motive for asking God for that thing? Is it because you saw somebody, you know, having the same thing, and suddenly, okay, I can have it. God give me this thing I need. That's wrong motive. You just want to continue upon your lust. What is your attitude? What's your relationship with your fellow brother and sister? Let's remember that the condition of our heart is what the Lord looks at when we go before Him. Jesus said in Mark 11:25-27, whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your heavenly Father may forgive your trespass. For if you do not forgive, then will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. This is a serious statement. Basically, God is saying that if you don't forgive that person, He didn't say that if they were wrong, or even if they were, whether they're right or wrong, doesn't matter. God wants you to forgive. Unforgiveness is big. For me, it's one of the biggest prayer blocker. Who is it in your life that you hold resentment against? Today, you need to release them from your heart. Say amen. Psalm 66 verse 16, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Somebody, you're not talking to your mother, you're not talking to your dad, you're not talking to somebody, a member of the family, and you are praying, you can fast every day, and you are holding because they offended you. God just blocked it. It's as simple as that. Yes, no pastor can pray or no prophet can change that. I heard of somebody for years. This person wasn't speaking to their parents, and the person be going to church every time we pray. And I mean, how does that work? And pastors, they'll be praying, they'll be fasting. Let pastors even and elders let them enjoy their own life. Sometimes you'll be fasting for people. And the most basic stuff that is so clear, God said, if you don't forgive, I will not forgive. And God blocks that. And somebody here, unless God reveals, and somebody is fasting and begging God for you, please make our job easier. Please, okay? I'm talking about a real life example, you know, that happened some years back, you know. Quickly, I need to round up now. The fifth one, always give God thanks. We know all these things. It's just to give an awareness today, to take us around and always give God thanks. If we're very honest with ourselves, God has done a lot for us, for you and I, and we need to give Him thanks. Never, ever let gratitude be away from your heart. Always show gratitude. Even in little things, you want to pack, somebody just pulls out, Father, thank you for that. You go to somebody, they give you something, a blessing. Father, thank you. Jesus healed 10 lepers, only one came and said, where are the 9? What I'm saying this morning is that have a heart of gratitude towards God. Even a child, if they keep coming to you, giving them money, they never say thank you. It will do something, even though they're your children. In fact, you teach them, you say, what are you doing? You know. So what I'm saying is that let us always honor God. Say amen. And because of time, I need to actually round up. There. We'll pick it up from next week as well. In conclusion, what I want to say this morning is that let's bow down our head. Let's bow down our heads to pray. I want you to just talk to God in your heart and repent of any prayerlessness and ask the Holy Spirit to help you to come to another level in your prayer life in the name of Jesus. Just talk to God for a minute and then I'm going to pray. Father, we want to thank you. Thank you for your word today. Lord, we're asking, oh Lord, that by your Spirit you give us the grace to live a life of obedience to your word. Not just that, but to live a life of prayer, because this is what you demonstrated to us when you came. Lord, teach us to pray. Lord, teach us to come up higher in our relationship with you. Let our prayer level receive. Let our prayer level come up to another level. Father, we want to thank you. Father, we bless you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And I just want to pray, if you're listening to this sermon and you've never surrendered your heart to Jesus, I just want to pray a prayer of salvation. If you've never said this prayer, look, except a man be born again, they can never inherit God's kingdom. So I want you to just repeat this prayer after me. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I come before you this afternoon asking you to forgive me of my sins. Help me, Lord Jesus, to live for you. I ask that you come into my heart. I seek you as my Lord, as my Savior. Help me to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. And for those who may be saying that prayer for the first time, I just want to pray over you. Father, I pray for anyone that said that prayer for the first time. Father, we ask of God that you cause them to grow, to be rooted in Christ, in the name of Jesus. And the devil will not snatch them away from God's kingdom. Father, we bless you. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Our God is good.